A rancher was hunting in the mountains of West Texas, and up high in a cliff, he came across an eagle's nest. He took one of the eaglet eggs back to the ranch from the nest and placed it under one of the hens who was sitting on her little chickens. Eventually, the eagle's egg hatched at the same time the little chicks hatched. So the eagle made its home in the barnyard, not knowing a difference between himself and all the little chicks. He ate with the chicks, slept with the chicks, walked with the chicks, acted like a chick. One day, a huge eagle from the nearby mountain swooped down over the barnyard in search of prey and hoping to get some food for the afternoon. Now, when the mother chicken saw the eagle flying down over the coop, she began to let out a harsh scream. She squawked to get little chicklets and the eaglet back to safety. But right after she let out a scream, came the louder and more majestic sound of the eagle as it swooped down over the barnyard. Now, all the little chickens responded to the mother hen as she was running back and her squawking, but not the little eaglet. It listened to the higher voice of the eagle above and took flight, following it to the heights. The Bible tells us in Isaiah 40 and verse 31, they that wait upon the Lord shall mount up on wings as eagles. This is the way God describes us as the high flyers in his precious word. He's called us, believe it or not, to fly over our frustrations, to fly over our fears, and to fly over the foes that sometimes assail us on a weekly basis. He doesn't want us cackling around in a chicken coop surrounded by chicken poop. He designed it in our spiritual DNA to soar high. This is the way God created us, over our sadness, as we wait like the eagle does for the divine wind of the Holy Spirit to lift our wings. Well, in Psalm 141, David is at a place of peril that could have possibly generated a chicken-like panic. As we've seen repeated times in the last year, he's being hunted and hounded and harassed by hateful King Saul, who has been out for David's hide for a long time. Now, David's followers have been dispirited and dispersed, distressed and discouraged. Now, could you imagine being told as a young person in life that you would be the president of the United States of America someday? And then you were actually given the position, sworn into office, and you were imagining in your mind that at some point you were going to be the individual to change the course of world events. And then all of a sudden, every harrowing event you could ever imagine began to take place in your life. And instead of soaring to the office of president, you are running like a rabbit in the wilderness for your life. That's precisely what happened to young heir to the throne, King David. Only David knew in his heart he was not a chicken. He was not a rabbit. That God had sovereignly designed him to soar. And so with that soaring mentality, he enters this psalm and he talks boldly to the Almighty in verse 1. Oh Lord, I call upon you. Hasten to me. Give ear to my voice when I call to you. See, I love David's intimacy with the Lord. David had this close connection with God so he could step up and say, Lord, here I am. I know you love me. Listen to me. I read recently about a gentleman who would come to the Lord, and here's how he would pray. Hello, Jesus. This is Jim. Mary's sick. Would you please meet her needs? Or, hello, Jesus. I was really convicted by Pastor's sermon last Sunday to change this in my character. And this is the way he would pray over and over again. Hello, Jesus. This is Jim. Eventually, after many years, it came time for Jim to die. And a pastor who visited him reported Jim's last words. He said, "You know, Pastor, Jesus just came, and you know what he said to me? Hello, Jim. This is Jesus." The way you approach him, he's going to approach you. And if you're in that one-to-one, close, confident level, you will find him coming to you in the same way. David would run to the Lord in his times of peril, and God would run to David's side to rescue him. And he wants to do the same for you. That's why David told us in Psalm 23, the Lord is my personal, intimate shepherd. Verse 2. May my prayer be counted as incense before you, the lifting of my hands as the evening offering. See, he's thinking about Exodus 37, when the incense of the priests in the tabernacle was offered morning and evening as symbolic of God's prayers being given to the people. And so that picture in his mind has been transported into his prayers, offered up continually as an incense, a sweet-smelling savor in the nostrils of God. He is saying, though, in his prayer, "Lord, hear me, help me, I'm hurting." But what I like about the prayer is that he's not rageful or resentful. See, he's under the gun. He's under attack by a notorious enemy. But David has no desire to attack back, which I find interesting. He is not against the crooked king. He's not against his creepy cronies. He's not against any of those people who are out for his hide. Instead, he demonstrates incredible character in the crisis by not giving in to what we would call the chicken coop mentality, running and squawking and trying to find a hiding place from the eagle. David said, "No, I am the eagle. Even though Saul treats me like a chicken, I know in my heart I'm an eagle. And God has designed me to fly high, as he has for every one of us today seated in this sanctuary." Now, David soars above his stress by offering in this passage four eagle-like requests. These are the requests that all high flyers should follow. So the next time that someone treats you like a chicken, the next time you feel backed against the wall, the next time you're dealing with a crisis or a difficulty or a stressful situation, these are your prayer requests to lift you out of the chicken coop and fly high. The first request with an eagle-like mindset is this: in the midst of all the difficulty, Lord, teach me to tame my tongue. Look at verse 3. When my spirit was overwhelmed within me, you knew my path. That's 142. I go, that looks different. Look at verse 3. 3 of Psalm 141. I kept looking for tongue in that verse. I couldn't find it. Here it is. Set a guard, O Lord, over my mouth. There it is. Keep watch over the door of my lips. That's the first prayer he offers with an eagle-like mindset. David had a tender heart towards the Lord, but like all of us, he had a tendency towards voicing his complaints and attacking those who sought to attack him. David said, "I'm tempted to speak out against Saul. I'm tempted to become resentful of the Lord's anointed." And all that anger and mistreatment could have surfaced in his soul and erupted out in mean ways. And he knew that Saul's cronies and spies were watching what David was saying and watching what he was doing at all times. So he said, "Lord, help me to be righteous. Teach me to tame my tongue. Help me to put a guard on the ivory palace gates." These are the ivory palace gates. They're the gates that protect the mucous membrane that gets you and me into trouble all the time, right? David said, "Protect this tongue. Help me not to let it flap in the breeze and get me into trouble." An inebriated man came stumbling out of a bar and almost knocked down his minister who happened to be walking by. He said, "Oh, Pastor, I'm so sorry for you to see me like this." The pastor said, "Well, Sam, I don't know why you're sorry for me to see you like this. The Lord sees you this way, doesn't he? And the drunk said, yeah, but he's not such a blabbermouth like you are. Oh, how I love to tell the story. Guess who I saw drunk tonight? David says, no, hold those things down. One of the great signs of maturity is when we learn to be quiet. There are things I hear all the time, and oftentimes I'm so tempted to tell my bride, and the Spirit of God will say, it's not necessary. Just keep it between you and me. Between you and me. And that's what David is saying, Lord, let's keep this between each of us. Watch over my lips, guard my mouth. Psalm 39:1, let's read that together, shall we? I said, I will guard my ways that I may not sin with my tongue. I will guard my mouth as with a muzzle while the wicked are in my presence. That's the same context as we have right here. I want to pierce them with pungent vocabulary, but help me to hold back. It was David's son Solomon who said in Proverbs 18:21, life and death are in the power of the tongue. It might interest you to know that's one of the verses that children learned this week through the 5 days from Proverbs. James said in James 3:6, the tongue is a fire. It's set apart by hell itself. Did you realize that? Sometimes when you and I utter the most hateful and vengeful and vindictive things, it's the devil and hell itself that is motivating the tongue to move. That's what the Bible says. James also says in James 3:8, the tongue is a restless evil. It's full of deadly poison. The tongue could be verbal cyanide aimed at eliminating our enemies. You know, at the end of the First World War, Germany was furious. And the reason they were is because they felt they had been mistreated by the Treaty of Versailles. There were other countries involved in starting the war, but Germany was the one primarily blamed. And consequently, the people of Germany were furious. And all their anger was like this huge bundle of dry kindling. And all it needed was one person to come and spark it. And of course, we know who rose. Adolf Hitler. In the early 30s, he spoke to a group of people in a beer cellar in Munich, Germany. And the inflammatory words of his mouth were mirrored on the faces of all the people that were present in that beer cellar that evening. There was an artist that was there that evening. And as he was speaking, he was portraying on canvas what the faces of the people looked like when it came to anger, rage, and resentment. And when he finished his classic painting, he wrote under it this caption, in the beginning was the Word. See, no one paid much attention when a young Adolf Hitler published his autobiography in the 1920s, Mein Kampf. But for every single word written in Mein Kampf, 125 lives were lost in the Second World War. Talk is not cheap. Vocabulary can kill. And so if we're wise, we'll ask God to help us muzzle the mucous membrane. Here's a good one that I like to think about. The fellow who put it this way, I'm careful of the words I speak to keep them soft and sweet. Never know from day to day which words I'll have to eat. David said, help me not to eat any words, to be careful with the tongue. That's the first prayer. His second eagle-like request is this, Lord, help me to walk away from wickedness. I'm going to be tempted to enter in. Help me to walk away from it. Verse 4, do not incline my ear to any evil thing, to practice deeds of wickedness, with men who do iniquity. And look at this line. Don't let me eat of their delicacies. Keep me away from that which is corrupt. Very similar to the line in our Lord's Prayer, we're to pray each day, lead us not into anyone? Temptation. Don't let me go that route. Don't put me in a position where I will be tempted to blow it with my words or my behavior. In other words, keep my character clean. One man put it this way. The difference between personality and character. Personality is what you are when lots of people are around. Character is who you are when everybody goes home. When everybody goes home. Character is who you are on the inside. And sometimes it's only you and the Lord who know what your true character is all about. It's like a little boy who came crying to his mother with a pronouncement. Hey, Mom, eating too many green apples can make a person sick. She said, well, son, how do you know that? He said, because I have inside information. Character is your inside information. You know what's happening. Others may not. Your private thoughts. You know, when you're tempted to hurt someone and hate them, in that private thought, even that's a sin. You could confess that before the Lord as murder. If you've undressed a woman in your eyes or in your thoughts before you've even seen one, you could confess that as adultery. Because anything that's happening in your heart or your mind is something that's already done as far as God's concerned. The deed is simply the outworking of our activity. And we, as a world, punish deeds, and we must, because we could only see deeds. But God sees deeper. That was the whole point of the Sermon on the Mount and the whole point of the message that he gave. God sees the heart. What's happening inside? And David said, keep my heart away from wickedness. Deal with my character. Now, when he makes the statement, don't let me eat of the delicacies of men who do iniquity, here's what he's saying. I'm finding myself very popular in unexpected quarters. You see, people knew they hated Saul, and they knew that David was the one who could do their dirty work. David had taken down the giant of Goliath, 9'4" beast, and if he could take down Goliath, they assumed he could certainly take down Saul, and so what was happening is that they were inviting him over to their home. They were having sumptuous banquets. They were trying to manipulate and motivate David to do their dirty work and end the reign of King Saul so that he might become monarch over Israel. And that was very, very tempting for David because God had promised that he would be the monarch. But David knew in his heart, I'm not going to forsake God's standard of leadership. I will wait for the right time before I become the right man. He said, don't allow me to become enticed by the delicacies of others. When I first became a full-time minister in 1976, I had a former employer of mine who worked for Allstate Insurance who was fairly wealthy. And he decided to pay for a radio program for me for 1 year. I was on the radio, Pastor Rick's Living for Christ Ministry, every morning or every Saturday morning at 8 a.m. He picked up the tab for that whole year. He gave me money to put as a down payment on my first new car. He brought me groceries each week. These were the delicacies. And then the temptation came eventually. Here's what I like you to preach over the airwaves. He had some pet peeves that he wanted me to preach. And I said, I'm sorry, my friend, but I can't take my directions from you when it comes to preaching. I preach the Word of God. And instantly, he withdrew his presence and withdrew all the perks. And as you walk with God, at times you're going to be tempted by others to take the wrong step and go the wrong route. David said, don't let me walk the way of wickedness. Don't let me be enticed by the delicacies. Now, the third eagle type request may be the hardest of all for you and me, but it demonstrates the character and the maturity of David. And here it is. In the midst of struggles, in the midst of stress, in the midst of painful times, David prays, let me accept loving admonishment. Let us say that together. Let me accept loving admonishment. I'm not surprised that only three people said that. Let's try it again. I understand. Even if you don't believe it, just mimic it anyway. Here we go. let me accept loving admonishment. Yes. Yes. Verse 5. Let the righteous smite me in kindness and reprove me. It is oil upon my head. Don't let my head refuse it. Here's the true test of maturity, isn't it? How do I handle it when someone hurts me in order to help me? The word smite, halam in the Hebrew, means to be broken. It's used in Judges 5:22 and translated to dash, or in 1 Samuel 14:16 to break down. I'm going to let the righteous person speak the truth to me. I will let that individual break me down. Even though it's painful, I know it will be helpful. Teach me to take those words in. And David taught these thoughts and these principles to his son Solomon, who later on spoke to us in Proverbs. So I want you to hold your finger here in Psalm 141. Turn to the very next book of the Bible. Should be easy to find. It's Proverbs. Look at chapter 9 and verse 8. Proverbs 9 and verse 8. Proverbs 9, 8. Do not reprove a scoffer. He's going to hate you. But if you reprove a wise man, what? He will love you. Wow. Look at chapter 17, one more. Proverbs 17 and verse 10. This is an interesting statement. A rebuke goes deeper into the one who has understanding than 100 blows into a fool. It's hard to be open. It's hard. But David was a man who practiced what he prayed. You know, later on in 2 Samuel 12, when Nathan came to convict David and to confront him on his double deeds with Bathsheba and Uriah, did he justify? Did he rationalize? Did he say, you know I'm a woman's man. You know the history of people. You can read 2 Samuel chapter 5. I've been doing this all my... No, he didn't say any of that. He said, I'm the one. I'm the one. How do you handle it when people come to you with a truth about your character? Are you quick to justify, quick to rationalize? If you are, everyone could see you are living a lie. And your respect drops lower and lower and lower in their eyes. You say, well, how do I handle it? Someone has made this suggestion, and I think it's a good one. It's been suggested that a standard reply to criticism could be this. You know, you may be right. You may be right. Let's say that together. You may be right. Maybe they're wrong, right? But at least it gives you a chance to think about it. And you're elevated in their eyesight as a man or woman of respect who regards the thought that they brought to you. You may be right. Could be right. Charles Haddon Spurgeon, the great Baptist preacher, put it even stronger. I'm not sure I'm willing to do what he said, but I want to throw it out anyway so you can hear it. Go tell, or get a friend to tell all your faults. Excuse me, get a friend to tell you all your faults, or better still, welcome an enemy who will watch you keenly and sting you savagely. What a blessing such an irritating critic will be to a wise man. What an intolerable nuisance to a fool. I like to get to that place. Pretty good, isn't it? He says in verse 5, let the righteous smite me in kindness and reprove me. Because, verse 8, my eyes are toward you, O Lord, my God. Now, he pictures the rebuke as the perfume being poured out in the heads of honored guests at an ancient banquet. Let me wear those wise words like an expensive designer cologne. That's why he says in verse 5, its oil on my head. It's like a perfume or oil. Don't let my head refuse it, for still my prayer is against their wicked deeds. Theirs is not a reference to verse 5, the people who are out to help him, but actually those in verse 4 who are out to hurt him, those who do iniquity. And so he's saying, since I don't want to be drawn into their wickedness, since I don't want to walk in their iniquity, here's the way I could keep myself holy and pure: by being open to the criticism and critiques of others who are close around me. You know who's the best person in your life to give you criticism and critique? If you're married, it's your spouse. It's your spouse. Because that person knows you better than anyone else on planet Earth, including your own children. Now, it's wise for the spouse to be gentle, to be loving, but spouses should also be accurate in holding their partner accountable, especially when it comes to areas of clear sin. I'm sorry, honey, I love you. We cannot do this. We cannot take this route. And then you trust those words because they're coming from God Himself. So that's a tough one. Lord, help me to be able to accept the insight of others. And then the fourth prayer request, and I think God will answer this if you have honestly offered the other three. Here it is. Protect me from pernicious people. You say, what does the word pernicious mean? It means deadly. It means fatal. It means people who want to take me down and push me under. Lord, keep me away from those who want to do me in. Verse 6. Their judges are thrown down by the sides of the rock, and they hear my words, for they are pleasant. Now you say, what's he talking about? He's referring to the ancient principle of just retribution, and he's thinking about a historical event that had recently took place in 2 Chronicles 25:12, when the sons of Judah threw 10,000 evil sons of Seir off a cliff and dashed them onto the rocks. And David said, that's what I like to see happen to my enemies, to go over the cliff and to die in the rocks. But Lord, I'm not going to do that. I'm asking you to protect me from the pernicious one. The pernicious one in David's life was Saul and all his army who was seeking out David and his men. David was tempted. He was motivated. I'm sure he was frothing at the mouth at times to reach out and to end Saul's life and to stop his sadness. I mean, it's been going on for 14 years. Enough is enough already. And maybe someone's been out for you for 14 years. Maybe you've had an enemy or a person who has been a foe in your life for a long time, and you're tempted to attack them back. God said, don't do it. Leave them in my hand. At the right time, in the right way, I will deal with your enemy. Happened for David, didn't it? 1 Samuel chapter 31 and verse 4, Saul made it easy by offing himself, falling on his own sword in battle, committing suicide, and then all the animosity, all the tension, all the anger, all the attacks instantly died. Suddenly David is without a foe, and leadership is open for him because he waited for God's time. Verse 6, they hear my words, for they are pleasant. What does that mean? The folks who turned against me will change their tune. So actually, when you wait for God to right the wrongs in your life and you don't attack the person who's attacking you, eventually the people who listen to that person who was attacking you will start listening to you. They will change their tune. And so what looks bad will eventually become much better. 5-year-old had an incredible interest in motorcycles. Whenever Harley flew by, whoo, he he let out a squeal of delight. And he'd shout to his friend, "Look at that! Look at that! I'm making a motorcycle like that someday." His father's answer was always the same. "Not as long as I'm alive, you won't." One day, another bike came flying by, and he said, "Look at that! I'm going to get one of those as soon as my dad dies." That's David. "I'm going to be reigning. I'm going to be ruling as soon as Saul dies." And God said, "I'll take care of Saul for you. I'm going to make it better." Verse 7. "As when one plows and breaks open the earth, our bones have been scattered at the mouth of Sheol." David and his crew look like they're destined for death because Saul's men were much mightier and stronger than David's, and it looks like he's going to take him down. Scattered at the mouth of Sheol means the mouth of the grave. It looks like we're going to die. But the vocabulary to plowing and breaking here is actually a farmer's vocabulary. So what he's saying is this. God's just plowing the earth in anticipation of sowing a seed. It looks like we're going under, but actually we're going to be coming up. So to others around us, we appear to be losing. But from God's perspective, we're going to be winning. We look like we're dying, but actually we're not. We're still alive. Listen to this. While walking through a graveyard in Vienna, a tourist heard music coming from a grave site. That's spooky. The headstone read, "Ludwig von Beethoven, 1770 to 1827. The man listened for a few moments before recognizing the music as the Ninth Symphony being played backward. Puzzled, he left the gravesite and persuaded a friend to return with him. By the time they came back to the grave, the music had changed. This time it was the Seventh Symphony, but like the previous place, it was being played backward. Curious, the men agreed to consult a music scholar. When the two men returned to the grave with the expert, the Fifth Symphony was being played, and again, backward. Well, naturally, the word got out, and a great crowd began to assemble around the gravesite. And so just then, the graveyard's caretaker ambled up to the group, and someone in the crowd asked, "Do you have an explanation for this music?" "Sure," he said. "Don't you get it? He's decomposing." "He looks dead. He's not dead. He's still alive." And that's what David is saying. There is still life in these broken bones. Our song will be sung again. We look weak. We look brittle. We're not. We're coming back. And we're not decomposing. Verse 8. "For my eyes, in the midst of all this death, they're toward you, O God, my Lord." Later, reflecting on that same statement, Solomon, his son, wrote in Proverbs 18:10, "The name of the Lord is a strong tower, and the righteous run into it, and they are safe." And maybe this is one of the reasons, if not the major reason, he's permitting pain and difficulty and sadness and loss and distress to enter your life, to enter my life. Because he knows when everything is going fine, we have a tendency to become self-sufficient saints. We talk to him only occasionally. But when we're under the gun, oh, how we run to him. In the times that I've recently gone through in this past year, when I've been overwhelmed by situations in my life, I can't tell you how much time I've spent in prayer. I don't have to work to pray. No one has to tell me to pray. I don't have to call a meeting to pray. I just pray and pray and pray and pray and pray. And I think God likes that. And so this is one of the reasons he allows us to go through tough times, so we will hook into him and draw closer to his side. David's doing it here. That's why he's saying, "My eyes are not towards people, they're towards you." Verse 8, "I take refuge in you. Don't leave me defenseless. keep me from the jaws of the trap which they've set before me and from the snares of those who do iniquity. David said, I'm not paralyzed. I'm not panic-stricken by the traps and snares and tricks of Saul. I will walk safely through all the military espionage. God will take care of me. Verse 10, let the wicked fall into their own nets while I pass by safely. That's a good one to put on a post-it, isn't it? You could put the person's name, let so-and-so fall into his or her own net while I pass by safely. And guess what? You're being biblical. You could do it. And you're not being vindictive, are you? Because you're not going to do anything with it. You're just giving it to the Lord. Isn't that wonderful? Aren't you glad you came today? Yes, you are. That's a great one. The wicked will fall into their own nets. Sometimes that's hard. When you look at a boss, you look at a person that's hurt you deeply, and they appear to be larger than life. Maybe it's a group of people who seem to be out for you. And you're saying, they are too strong. They're like the rock of Gibraltar. Well, rocks could be shattered, can't they? The bigger they are, the harder they fall. Hey, think about the pernicious rocks that have ruled throughout history and frightened the living daylights out of people. Nero, Napoleon, Hitler, Stalin, Mao Zedong, Saddam Hussein, Muammar Gaddafi, Osama bin Laden. Where are they at today? They are broken in pieces. They're destroyed. That's what God does. God steps in at the right time and he annihilates them. And the righteous pass by safely. And so, David, his sword, just like an eagle, has he not? Over all the stress points of this psalm. God's challenge to you today is not to squawk like a chicken, but to just put the wings out like the eagle. Don't flap. That's what the chicken does. Walk, walk, walk. No chickens. Just put them out. Get right to the edge. Wait for the wind. And then you'll soar. And you'll soar in God's time and in God's way. Many years ago, there was a man in a church I once pastored who was my friend. He and his whole family were good friends with me. Therefore, I was shocked and hurt when he turned against me in a public setting. Then I didn't see him because I was gone. The next time I saw him was at his funeral. And there was no contact between me and him. And I thought, that's strange, that's sad. I guess that's a chapter that will never be completely closed in my life. 10 years after that incident, his youngest son came up to me at a wedding. He said, Pastor Rick, I want to tell you something. Before my dad died, he told me, I will never again treat a minister the way I treated Pastor Rick. He said, son, always support the pastor. More often than not, he has the heart of God. This man had been attending a church for only 3 months, and they put the pastor out. You know what he did? He went with the pastor to start a new work. I said, why would you do that? He said, because I learned from the pain we put you through to support the pastor. God will come through for you. Just give him time. Let's bow together. God is real good at righting the wrongs in our lives. And if you don't know him as intimately and as personally as David did, then he wants to right one major wrong in your life this morning. That wrong is the sin that separates you from him. He sent his son to die on a cross to pay the penalty for all the sins that you have committed. He wants to cleanse you. He wants to draw you close to his side. But for that to take place, you need to admit that you've made mistakes, that you have sinned, that you have fallen short of a standard. And if you're willing to ask for forgiveness, Jesus will cleanse you and place you next to his side. And you, like David, will become a high flyer in life. It's very possible that God's spoken to your heart today. And he's saying, this is the moment for salvation. This is the point in time for you to make a decision to release your life as it's been into the hands of the one who could make it glorious and wonderful for the future. You're thinking, that's me. I want to make that decision for Christ today. If so, would you just take your right hand and lift it up good and high? If that's your desire and you want to pray the prayer to give your heart to Christ today, lift your hand good and high right now if that's where you happen to be today. God bless you, my friend. God bless you. If you would just pray this prayer with me. Dear Lord Jesus, I recognize I've made many mistakes in my life, but I know you will forgive me for my failures because you sent yourself to the cross and died a despicable death for my sins. You paid the penalty for me, and now I'm freed from all my past, all my failures, all my mistakes, and I'm accepted into your family by faith today. Make me the person you want me to be as I come to church each week, read your Bible each day, and talk to you throughout every day and night. Accept me into your family by faith today. I pray in Jesus' name, amen. We'll ask the worship team to come up at this time. And as they do, let us stand for our closing song this morning.